हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ एन आर जांगिड, पीजीटी इंग्लिश इन केंद्रीय विद्यालय आमी बनाड जोधपुर। आई वंस अगेन वेलकम यू ऑन माय यूट्यूब चैनल लर्न इंग्लिश विद जांगिड सर। डियर चिल्ड्रन, एज यू नो वी ऑल आर फेसिंग द लॉकडाउन ड्यू टू कोविड-19 वायरस, सो वी हैव टू डिवाइस we have to invent the new methods of teaching. That is why we KV teachers are here with you through the online mode to teach you. Dear children, today I am here with a very important lesson in class 10th language and literature course, and today we will discuss the second chapter, Nelson Mandela Long Walk to Freedom. I am sure you will enjoy learning through. Dear children, Nelson Mandela, you must have heard, was a freedom fighter of South Africa. He was the first black president of South African rule after the freedom in 1994. And this lesson has been taken from his autobiography, Long Walk to Freedom. It is one of the very famous books in world literature. So, one excerpt of this lesson has been taken in our course, in our syllabus. So, before we start, I just would like to give the introduction of such a great personality, Nelson Mandela. Nelson R. Mandela was born on 18 July 1918 and he passed away on 5th of December 2013, and he was a South African anti-apartheid revolutionary, political leader and philanthropist who served as president of South Africa from 1994 to 1999. He was the country's first black head of state and the first elected in a fully representative democratic election. His government focused on dismantling the legacy of apartheid. You must be knowing, apartheid is a system of racial discrimination. By tackling institutionalized racism and fostering racial reconciliation. Ideologically an African nationalist and socialist, he served as the president of the African National Congress party from 1991 to 1997. Now dear children, before we go to the text, I would like to show you a video highlighting in brief the achievements of Nelson Mandela and the swearing in ceremony in 1994 in the capital of South Africa. This video will definitely help you to understand the theme of this chapter in a better way.
His story is one of the most remarkable of any world leader. Few in history have endured oppression with such little rancor or overcome the oppressor with such little bloodshed.
I, Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela, do hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa.
In May 1994, Nelson Mandela, the man white South Africa had imprisoned for nearly 30 years, was sworn in as the country's first black president. Through his dignified and courageous leadership, the African National Congress had broken the stranglehold of apartheid and transformed South Africa into a multiracial democracy. Nelson Mandela was born in 1918 in South Africa's Eastern Cape. He was the son of a tribal chief. He qualified as a lawyer, and by 1952 he'd set up a legal partnership with a man who was to be a lifelong friend and ally, Oliver Tambo. Together they campaigned against apartheid, the exercise in social engineering under which South Africa's white minority, in charge of the country's military as well as economic forces, brutally crushed the human rights and aspirations of the black majority. In 1956, Mandela was among 156 political activists to be charged with high treason. The trial lasted more than 4 years before charges were dropped.
In Johannesburg, premier city of South Africa, thousands of coloured people went to attend a protest meeting called by the African National Congress.
By now, black resistance to apartheid was growing. Past laws which restricted where black people could live and work became the focus of resentment. Past books were burned as Mandela and others organized demonstrations against apartheid's leaders.
I despised them because they were despised by the entire world. They dressed in beautiful suits, silk shirts and silk ties, but they were beautiful outside and full of evil inside.
The Sharpeville massacre in 1960 forced the ANC to change strategy. 69 people died when police opened fire on black demonstrators. The ANC was outlawed, Mandela went underground, and peaceful resistance became a thing of the past.
There are many people who feel that it is useless and futile for us to continue talking peace and non-violence against a government whose reply is only savage attacks on an unarmed and defenseless people.
Mandela undertook a campaign of sabotage against the state. He was eventually arrested and charged with conspiracy to overthrow the government. At his trial, he made a 3-hour speech from the dock. A tape of it was discovered later. This, his final plea for freedom and democracy for all South Africans, was to echo down the 27 years he was to remain a political prisoner.
It is an idea for which I hope to live for and to see realized. But my Lord, if it needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die.
Sentenced to life imprisonment, he was sent to Robben Island, a top security prison in Cape Town's Table Bay. Photographs of Mandela were banned from publication. To quote him was an offence. But, astonishingly, he wasn't embittered by his long imprisonment.
We soon grasped the fact that we are not conducting a struggle against individual whites. We are fighting a principle, fighting white domination. And in the course of that struggle, we can even form friendships with people from the other side.
Outside, time was running out for apartheid. With the ANC leadership in jail, even the children of Soweto were now helping to sustain the revolution. The hardline government of P.W. Botha tried to crush the uprising, but gradually, more liberal white people began to recognize that Mandela was the solution, not the problem. An international campaign was begun for the release of Nelson Mandela as, around the world, governments imposed sanctions on South Africa. In 1990, a courageous white leader, President F.W. de Klerk, announced that the ANC would be unbanned. That February, after 27 years of imprisonment, Nelson Mandela walked to freedom with his then-wife Winnie at his side. Worldwide pressure had borne fruit. But hope soon turned to despair. Township violence left blacks fighting blacks. Mandela repeatedly appealed for peace.
Take your guns, your knives, and your pandas, and throw them into the sea.
Mandela's appeal was largely ignored. Black people were massacring each other, even as Mandela was negotiating a new democratic constitution. The country's first multiracial elections in 1994 resulted in a landslide victory for the ANC. Millions enjoyed their first taste of democracy. people from all races welcomed the vote as a new beginning for the country. The process of national reconciliation was helped by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which gave the victims of apartheid the opportunity to tell their stories and, in some cases, to confront their oppressors.
What kind of men, listening to those moans and cries and groans, what kind of men is that?
It was a painful process for everyone. Yet for all his political skills, Mandela found it difficult to tackle many of South Africa's endemic social problems. Chief among them were the acute shortage of affordable housing, the widespread poverty, and the scourge of AIDS. In December 1997, Nelson Mandela gave up the presidency of the African National Congress in favor of South Africa's vice president, Thabo Mbeki, who also succeeded him as head of state. Mandela was feted throughout the world, as here in London. But there'd been personal sadness. His long-time marriage to Winnie, once known as the mother of the nation, had ended following her involvement in the kidnapping and murder of a student activist. In 1998, at the age of 80, he married Graça Machel, the widow of the late president of Mozambique. It was a marriage which brought him personal happiness and helped him to enjoy the family life which had been denied to him by his long commitment to the struggle against apartheid. On the eve of the new millennium, Nelson Mandela had revisited the cell on Robben Island, where he'd spent 18 of the 27 years he was imprisoned. He lit a candle to symbolize reconciliation. It was passed to an African child to represent that continent's hope for the future. A hope inspired by the life and ideals of one of the truly great leaders of our time, Nelson Mandela.
Now you must have got the theme. Now we will see the text. 10th May. So actually the new South African government took office on 10th of May 1994 after the freedom from the white rule, and the white people ruled over South Africa around 300 years, and after such a long period the African people got their freedom, they got their own government first time. And here we are discussing the opening ceremony of the new government. So here Nelson Mandela, since it is autobiographical narration, so Nelson Mandela says, 10th May dawned bright and clear. For the past few days I had been pleasantly besieged here means surrounded, by dignitaries and world leaders who were coming to pay their respects before the inauguration. Actually African people got their freedom, then there were the general elections, and the party of Nelson Mandela won the maximum seats and they came to power. And before this opening ceremony, many world leaders, many officers, ambassadors of different countries, they congratulated Nelson Mandela and they paid their respect to the new government. The inauguration would be the largest gathering ever of international leaders on South African soil. The ceremonies took place in the lovely Sandstone Amphitheater. Amphitheater is actually a theater, a big theater. It is open, and in the South African capital Pretoria, it is made of sandstone. So the ceremonies took place in the lovely sandstone amphitheater formed by the Union Buildings in Pretoria. For decade means a period of 10 years. So for decades this had been the seat of white supremacy. Actually on this seat, in this building, the white people were ruling, so they were sitting on the seat. So for many years they hold the seat of this amphitheater in Pretoria, and now it was the site of a rainbow, gathering of different colors and nations for the installation of South Africa's first democratic and non-racial government. So in 1994, the first democratic government after the general democratic election, Nelson Mandela won and he became the president. And this government was non-racial, means there was no discrimination based on the color of the skin. On that lovely autumn day, so you see autumn day, autumn here is symbolic. Autumn, when autumn comes, we all know the leaves of the trees, they fell down, and after some time we have spring, the happy season, the trees just grow new tiny plants, and after some time of autumn everywhere you can see a good greenery. So for the African people, certainly it was the autumn day, because now it was the last time of the white rule and now their own rule was there. So on the lovely autumn day, I was accompanied by my daughter Jinani. The daughter was with him. On the podium, on the stage, Mr. D. Clark was first sworn in as second deputy president. So the different officials and different people were taking the oath. First of all, Mr. D. Clark, he took the oath as second deputy president. Then Thabo Mbeki was sworn in as first deputy president. Thabo Mbeki was given the post of first deputy president. When it was my turn, I pledged to obey and uphold. Uphold means to keep up the constitution and to devote myself to the well-being of the republic and its people. To the assembled guests and the watching world, I said. So here the speech of Nelson Mandela is given. Today all of us do, by our presence here, confer glory, means give glory and hope to newborn liberty. Out of the experience of an extraordinary human disaster. So here extraordinary human disaster refers to the slavery of the white people that lasted too long, that lasted around, as I told you, for 300 years. Must be born a society of which all humanity will be proud. We who were outlaws, means who were called the rebels before some time because they were fighting for the freedom of Africa, not so long ago, have today been given the rare privilege to be host to the nations of the world on our own soil. We thank all of our distinguished international guests for having come to take position with the people of our country of what is, after all, a common victory for justice. Nelson Mandela calls it a common victory for justice, for peace, and more importantly for human dignity, because it was the end of the racial government. We have at last achieved our political emancipation. At last, he says that they have achieved their political freedom, their political liberty. We pledge ourselves to liberate, to free all our people from the continuing bondage of poverty, deprivation, suffering, gender and other discriminations. So he pledged, he just promised to the people that he would try to just abolish poverty, to just also abolish deprivation and different kind of sufferings, torture of the people, and there would be no discrimination based on color and gender. Never, never and never again shall it be that this beautiful land will again experience the oppression, the torture of one by another. The sun shall never set on so glorious a human achievement. Let freedom reign. God bless Africa. So this is the historic address, speech of South African new president Nelson Mandela after taking oath as the president. Now some oral comprehension questions we will see, dear children. Where did the ceremonies take place? We know in the beautiful amphitheater of the Union Buildings in Pretoria. Can you name any public buildings in India that are made of sandstones? So many buildings are there, like the Red Fort in Delhi, the fort of Mehrangarh in Jodhpur, and so many other buildings are made of sandstone in India. Can you say how 10 May is an autumn day in South Africa? Definitely it was an autumn day, because it was the end of the white supremacy, the white rule, and it was the beginning of the new democratic and non-racial government in Africa. At the beginning of his speech, Mandela mentions an extraordinary human disaster. Already we have discussed, it was the slavery of the white people, the torture of the white people. What does he mean by this? What is the glorious human achievement? Here the glorious human achievement is the political freedom of South African people from the white people. What does Mandela thank the international leaders for? He thanked all the international leaders who had come there for coming and witnessing that opening ceremony. What ideals does he set out for the future of South Africa? So the ideals were very clear, that the government would be democratic, non-racial, there would be no discrimination among the people on gender or color or any kind of the other things. He also promised to alleviate poverty and deprivation. Now after the ceremony, he is describing one very important scene. A few moments later, we all lifted our eyes in awe, in surprise, as a spectacular array, means a very beautiful line of South African jets, aeroplanes, helicopters and troop carriers rode in perfect formation over the Union buildings. Means one aerial show was there. A group of helicopters and fighter planes and troop carriers just flew past over the Union buildings. It was a fly past. It was not only a display of pinpoint precision, it was a perfect display and military force, but a demonstration of the military's loyalty to democracy. They were expressing their loyalty, their sincerity to the new government, to a new government that had been freely and fairly elected only moments before. Now here he recalls that what happened before some time. The highest generals of the South African Defence Force and police, their chest bedecked means decorated with ribbons and medals from days gone by, saluted me and pledged their loyalty. I was not unmindful of the fact that not so many years before they would not have saluted but arrested me. Now here he actually recalls with a little bit pain that before the freedom, before some time when they were fighting for the freedom of Africa, the same people, the same officers, the same generals of defense, they arrested him. Finally, a chevron of Impala jet. Chevron means wheel shape by the aeroplanes. Impala is the name of a famous fighter plane. Left a smoke trail of the black, red, green, blue and gold of the new South African flag. Means they made a formation with different colors, which were the part of the new South African flag. The day was symbolized for me by the playing of our two national anthems and the vision of the whites singing Nakosi Sikelel I Africa and black singing Die Stem. On that day actually two national anthems were sung, because now there was no discrimination on the base of the color, white or the black. So the national anthem of the white people was first sung, and then the new national anthem of the blacks, which is called Die Stem, which was sung. The old anthem of the republic, although that day neither groups knew the lyrics of the anthem they once despised, they would soon know the words by heart. He says that before some time the people, particularly the white people, they hated the lyrics of the national anthem Die Stem, but after some time they will definitely learn it by heart. On the day of the inauguration, I was overwhelmed. He says, I was extremely happy with a sense of history. Now he is describing some historical events, means the journey of his freedom. In the first decade year means 1900 to 1910. A few years after the bitter Anglo-Boer war and before my own birth, the white-skinned peoples of South Africa paced up their differences and erected a system of racial domination against the dark-skinned peoples of their own land. Historically, the rule of the white people was established after the Anglo-Boer War. Boer is a region in South Africa where the tribal people live, and this region is particularly very rich in gold and diamonds. So this war actually lasted from 1899 to 1902, and after 1902 the white rule was established. So he is recalling that after this war the racial government was set up. The structure they created formed the basis of one of the harshest. He says that after that time, after this first decade of 20th century, there was the harshest system of government, the most painful, most inhuman. It was not human at all. Societies the world has ever known. Now in the last decade of the 20th century and my own 8th decade as a man, now he is discussing about the last decade, means this present time, 1991 to 2000, that system had been overturned. He says that in the first decade the system was established, and now in the last decade the system was overthrown, the system was overturned forever and replaced by one that recognized the rights and freedoms of all peoples regardless of the color of their skin. That day had come about through the unimaginable sacrifices of thousands of my people. Now, dear children, he is actually recalling the great sacrifice of the people of Africa to get this freedom. And we know without any sacrifice and without any loss, we cannot achieve anything. People whose suffering and courage can never be counted or repaid. I felt that day, as I have on so many other days, that I was simply the sum of all those white African patriots. Patriot is a lover of the nation, who had gone before me. He says that many people lost their lives and many people contributed in the freedom of Africa, and I am just the sum of these white African patriots, means I am a representative of these freedom fighters. That long and noble line ended and now began again with me. I was pained that I was not able to thank them and that they were not able to see what their sacrifices has wrought, means has just brought. He was actually paying tribute to the people, to the freedom fighters who had sacrificed their lives for the nation. And he was also feeling regretful that they were not able to see this glorious day of freedom. The policy of apartheid created a deep and lasting wound in my country and my people. All of us will spend many years, if not generations, recovering from the profound hurt. So he says that by the system of apartheid, the people of Africa really got hurt deeply. And now it would take a long time to recover from that hurt. But the decades of oppression and brutality, cruelty, had another unintended effect, and that was that it produced. Now he says that although our people suffered a lot, the white people were very cruel, they were very brutal, they tortured our people, they exploited our people, but due to their oppression, due to their exploitation, great freedom fighters actually were born, like the Oliver Tambos. Oliver Tambo was a famous freedom fighter, the Walter Sisulu's, the Chief Luthuli's, the Yusuf Dedu's, the Bram Fischer's, the Robert Subukwe's of our time, men of such extraordinary courage, wisdom and generosity that their like may never be known again. So he is paying tribute to these freedom fighters. And one important thing you see, dear children, he is using plurals. Like, he is not like Tembu. Name is Tembu. He is writing Tembu's. Name is Sisulu. He is writing Sisulu's. So he wants to represent the common freedom fighters of Africa. Perhaps it required such depth of oppression to create such heights of character. He says that when people are oppressed, then really they develop a very good character and such a height of their character. Means great people are the product of some kind of oppression and difficulties. My country is rich in the minerals and gems that lie beneath its soil, but I have always known that its greatest wealth is its people, finer and truer than the purest diamonds. So he gives credit to the people of Africa. He says that Africa is rich in gold, diamonds and gems, but the real diamonds, the real gems of his country are the people of Africa who fought for the freedom of the country. It is from these comrades, it is from these friends in the struggle that I learned the meaning of courage. Now he is describing what is courage for him. Time and again I have seen men and women risk and give their lives for an idea. I have seen men stand up to attack and torture without breaking, showing a strength and resilience that defies the imagination. I learned that courage was not the absence of fear. So according to Mandela, courage doesn't mean absence of fear, but the triumph over it. Means the victory over the fear is actually courage. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers, who wins that fear. No one is born hating another person because of the color of his skin or his background or his religion. Mandela believes that no people, no person should be hated due to the color of the skin or of the background or of the caste. People must learn to hate, and if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love. He says that people really must know how to hate, because after learning how to hate, they learn how to love. For love comes more naturally to the human heart than its opposite. Even in the grimmest times in prison, when my comrades and I were pushed to our limits, I would see a glimmer of humanity in one of the guards. He actually remembers the time when he was in prison. He says that although the white people tortured us a lot, but sometimes the guard of the prison showed a little bit humanity, a little bit kindness to them. So he says that it was a glimmer, it was a glimpse of the goodness of people. Perhaps just for a second, but it was enough to reassure me and keep me going. Man's goodness is a flame. Very important, beautiful line. Man's goodness is a flame that can be hidden, but never extinguished. We can hide the flame of goodness, but you cannot put it out. You cannot extinguish it. Now there are some comprehension questions. What do the military generals do? What do they do? We have learned they saluted him. How has their attitude changed and why? Before some time they arrested him, and now since he was the president, so they now saluted him. Why were two national anthems sung? Already we have discussed. How does Mandela describe the system of government is in his country in the first decade and in the final decade? First decade, the racial government was set up, and in the final decade, the non-racial and democratic government was set up. Courage mean to Mandela, we have discussed. Which does he think is natural, to love or to hate? So it is obviously love. In life, every man has twin obligations. Now he is describing about the duty of a person. He says that everybody has two duties, two obligations in his or her life. Obligation to his family. First one is the obligation to his family, to his parents, to his wife and children. And he has an obligation to his people, to community, to his country. And second obligation is to the people, to the community, to the country. In a civil and human society, each man is able to fulfill those obligations according to his own inclinations and abilities. So he says that in a good society, in a civil society, we can easily perform both our duties. Means we can take care of our family as well as we can also take care of our people. But in a country like South Africa, it was almost impossible for a man of my birth and color to fulfill both of those obligations. But he says that during the time of slavery, it was not possible in Africa for a black person to perform both the duties. In South Africa, a man of color who attempted to live as a human being was punished and isolated. That if you live peacefully in South Africa in that time, in the time of the white people, you would be punished without any fault, and you would be isolated. People would despise you, hate you. We have seen one example of such a thing in Africa with our Gandhiji. We know when he was in Africa, he was not allowed to board a train in the first class coach because of the black color of his skin. In South Africa, a man who tried to fulfill his duty to his people was inevitably ripped, means cut, from his family and his home, and was forced to live a life apart, a twilight existence of secrecy and rebellion. So he says that in Africa, if you love your country, means if you love your own people, African people, then the white people will punish you. Then you cannot live peacefully. Then you have to live secretly, and you have to live a life of a freedom fighter, like a rebel who just moves from place to place. I did not know in the beginning, choose to place my people above my family, but in attempting to serve my people, I found that I was prevented from fulfilling my obligation as a son, a brother, a father, and a husband. So he says that when I was a child, I did not understand. I thought everything was okay, but when he grew older, he understood that he was prevented from fulfilling his duty as a son, a brother, a father, and a husband. I was not born with the hunger to be free. Now, he is very honestly describing that when he was small, there was no hunger for freedom. I was born free, free in every way that I could know, free to run in the fields near my mother's hut, free to swim in the clear stream that ran through my village, free to roast millets, roast that corn, makka, under the stars and ride the broad backs of slow-moving bulls. He says that in childhood I could enjoy every freedom in my childhood. As long as I obeyed my father and abided by the customs of my tribe, I was not troubled by the laws of man or God. He says that nobody disturbed me in my own life. It was only when I began to learn that my boyhood freedom was an illusion. He says that it was a complete imaginary thing. It was not a concrete thing. It was just like a doubt, an illusion. When I discovered as a young man that my freedom had already been taken from me, that I began to hunger for it. So he says that after the young age, he learnt that their people were not free. Then his hunger for freedom began to start. At first, as a student, I wanted freedom only for myself, the transitory, the temporary freedoms of being able to stay out at night, read what I pleased, and go where I chose. Later, as a young man in Johannesburg, I yearned, I wished for the basic and honorable freedoms of achieving my potential, of earning my keep, of marrying and having a family, the freedom not to be obstructed in a lawful life. But then I slowly saw that not only was I not free, but my brothers and sisters were not free. So he realized in the white rule that the black people were not free. I saw that it was not just my freedom that was curtailed, that was restricted, but the freedom of everyone who looked like I did. That is when I joined the African National Congress. So he says that after that I joined the African National Congress. This organization was fighting for the freedom of the country. And that is when the hunger for my own freedom became the greatest hunger for the freedom of my people. So he says that my freedom turned into the freedom of my people. Now I wanted freedom for my people. It was this desire for the freedom of my people to live their lives with dignity and self-respect. He wanted dignity and self-respect for the people of his own country that animated my life, that transformed a frightened young man. He says that only this desire totally changed me from a frightened young man into a bold one. He says that he became a bold person. They draw a law-abiding attorney. He says that I was an advocate. I was a lawyer and I always believed in law. But then I became a criminal in the eyes of the white people. They turned a family-loving husband into a man without a home. He says that I left my home. That forced a life-loving man to live like a monk. That I just became like a monk. Monk means a person who has no association with anybody, who is above all the material gains and all the family members in the world. I am no more virtuous or self-sacrificing than the next man, but I found that I could not even enjoy the poor and limited freedoms I was allowed when I knew my people were not free. Freedom is indivisible. He says that you cannot divide freedom. It should be given to all. The chains on any one of my people were the chains on all of them. He says that suppose one person of his country was put some restrictions, then it was the restrictions on all of the people. The chains on all of my people were the chains on me. I knew that the oppressor must be liberated just as surely as the oppressed. Now he is very kind person also. He says that the oppressor is also the slave of hate, hatred. So he also should be liberated. A man who takes away another man's freedom is a prisoner of hatred, because such people are also the prisoners of hatred. He is locked behind the bars of prejudice, biasness and narrow-mindedness. Such people are suffering from narrow-mindedness and prejudice. I am not truly free if I am taking away someone else's freedom. He says that he is not free if he is trying to take the freedom of other people. Means we should respect the freedom of other people while enjoying our own freedom. Just as surely as I am not free when my freedom is taken from me. The oppressed and the oppressor alike are robbed of their humanity. He says that both are robbed. Oppressed is robbed because he suffers a lot, and oppressor because he does not like other people and he just takes away the freedom of other people. So dear children, this is the beautiful story of Nelson Mandela, long walk to freedom. Now a few more questions. What twin obligations? Here we know one obligation is for the country and one obligation is for the family. What did being free mean to Mandela as a boy? As a boy, he just believed that playing wherever he wanted, going wherever he wanted, swimming in any of the rivers, whatever he wanted to learn, he could learn. It was just the freedom for him. How does he contrast this transitory freedom with the basic and honorable freedoms? But later on, as a student, as a young man, he realized that he and his people were not free. Does Mandela think the oppressor is free? No, the oppressor is not free because he is the prisoner of hatred. So dear children, this is all for today in this lesson. I hope you understand. Still, if you have any doubt, you can write in the comment box. You can personally message me. I will definitely try to solve your queries. So once again, thank you very much. Please like, share, comment and subscribe my YouTube channel and this lesson. Thank you and have a good day.